So
yeah, you really have to throw yourself in the deep end.
Yeah.
I mean, just the graft required, right? I remember when you first told me about, I mean, you let me come help you one day at the museum.
Do you remember that?
That's right, yeah. That was so dope. I was so stoked you did that for me, man. That was so cool.
I knew you were skint.
Oh, mate. It was so good too, because you gave me a bit of money, right? And it would have been, that did me for about a week or so. Right when I ran out of money, my first Centrelink pay came through. And yeah, I've never been able to thank you for that, because you did me such a fucking solid. And I was so skint, but I was fucking trying, eh? That's hilarious. But yeah, I remember when I was helping you set up and you were telling me, you know, all the little fiddly bits that you had me doing. You're like, yeah, I did that for this amount of months you know, for this many years. And I thought, fuck, it's like being a sushi chef.
Yeah.
Like you're washing rice for so long.
Yeah.
Is that what it was? How long were you a trainee before you were?
Well, I did assisting for about, 6 years, 6-7 years assisting. I started off in London. And then I came to Australia for a year or so, and then I went back to London, and then I went to New York. And then I went back to London after that, where I started working for myself. So all in all, probably about 6 or 7 years of like an apprenticeship, assisting people. Yeah. Actually, saying that, when I was assisting, if you wanted to be a freelance assistant back in the 80s, you had to have had 3 years full-time experience with somebody before you could even become a freelancer.
Oh, wow.
It was pretty full-on. But that was in London. But when I went to New York, it was all different. Because in New York, by that stage, assisting was already a profession. So what had happened is you get some photographer who wanted to be assistant, and he might assist a guy for a couple of years, and then suddenly find he's married with a kid, and suddenly finds he can't actually afford to be a photographer. Because he's earning so much money assisting.
Yeah, right.
And these guys could earn $400 or $500 a day in New York assisting. So to become a photographer meant you had to suddenly not work for maybe a year.
Give up your personal practice.
So these guys just didn't do it. So, yeah, going to New York for me was a big eye-opener, because I met these guys the first time I was there, I was working for a guy called Bert Stern, and Bert Stern was a famous photographer back from the 60s. He's a guy who photographed Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah, right.
And Bert was about, Bert was about 60 when I met Bert. And I met his assistant on the first day, and the assistant was about 45. And I thought, fuck, that's an old guy. He's an old assistant. Because I was, I was 20.
Yeah.
I thought, he's an old guy to be assisting. He said, oh, no, I've been doing this for 25 years. That's all he did. I couldn't get my head around, why would you be an assistant for that long? Why? Because in my head, he said, you assist for a while and you become a photographer.
Mm.
But I soon realised in New York, that's a full-on job. Then these guys, this guy who worked for Bert Stern, he was on about $800 a day. He was an amazing assistant. I probably actually learned more from him, technically, than Bert Stern.
Yeah, right.
I mean, Bert Stern had the vision and but technically, those assistants in New York were unbelievable. They could smell flair, they were... Because everything was shot on transparency, there was no retouching. Everything had to be absolutely perfect.
I mean, were they also the ones that would kind of open up a bit too? Was there a bit of bravado about the photographers?
Yeah, well, they didn't care. They didn't care because, once you become professional, you could then go and hire somebody and goes, oh, I hear you've worked for Annie Leibovitz. Can you give me a Leibovitz light? Can you give me a Mapplethorpe light? And he goes, yeah, sure, no problem. That's what they're there to do.
Wow.
And actually, the reason I stopped assisting was because I got to the stage in New York where I was being asked to assist for other people who had no experience. They were rich kids from New York. And I remember this one job in particular, don't know who this guy was, he called me up and said, oh, here, you work for so-and-so, I can pay you $500 a day, come and assist me. I turned up, we had like Naomi Campbell and some other top model in this honey wagon driving around Central Park in New York. And he had amazing, he had a stylist, great clothes, he had great hair and makeup. He didn't know how to hold a camera, this guy. He had no idea. And as I was being paid, so I had to basically help him. I had to make him, he took great pictures. So I had to tell him how to do it.
You had your arms around the back.
Pretty much. And then I thought, fuck, I'm not doing this anymore. I haven't spent all this time to give away my knowledge. Unlike a New York assistant who wouldn't care. To them, just a day's work. But for me personally, it's like, no. So I couldn't do it. So this one, I started assisting, and I flew back to London.
Wow.
To work for myself.
It's an awesome story.
Yeah.
I mean, it speaks to the American mentality.
Oh, absolutely. And this guy had no clue. He had, he was rich. He was rich, rich, rich.
Mm.
You know, I mean, that one day shoot for him would have cost him, I reckon, $20,000 to hire the honey wagon.
$20,000?
To hire the honey wagon, all the cameras. He had top models, like big models. We're talking supermodels in the 80s, you know. And he got some good pictures for his book.
I mean, a kilo of coke, he'd have to shout the models too.
Yeah, probably. It was like, yeah, that's what made me realise, oh, I can't do this, I can't give. I guess it was more of an English thing, where what you learn for yourself. America was completely different. America was like, assistance is now a profession.